Hi, it's Katrina. Number 10, the mystery of the keyhole. Scientists can't seem to figure out why ancient societies all over the world had a fascination with monuments in the shape of a keyhole. Civilizations that lived thousands of miles apart and at vastly different times in history all had an obsession with keyholes. For example, the Well of Santa Cristina in Italy was built as a sacred site by the Nuragic civilization sometime around the 12th century BC. It was crafted by remarkably skilled masons who had advanced knowledge of stoneworking. Sadly, nobody left behind any written records of what the keyhole-shaped well was used for. Archaeologists believe it had something to do with secret meetings and cultic rituals. There was a larger site around the well, although the well itself was the focal point of the shrine. It could have been a cult dedicated to fertility or some kind of water god. In Saudi Arabia, researchers recently found ancient tombs that are also quite old and a long way from Italy. Researchers with the University of Western Australia surveyed the hundreds of key-shaped tombs from a helicopter, shocked to see they make up a kind of highway of the dead through the desert. In Japan, there are the keyhole tombs, undoubtedly the most mysterious. In Osaka alone, there are over 44 burial mounds, each shaped like a keyhole. They are truly massive, built between the 3rd century and 6th century AD. People of great social status were buried inside these megalithic keyhole tombs, including Emperor Nintoku. But still, we don't know why the keyhole shape was so important. According to Mr. Kurahashi, curator of the Sakai Museum, the shape is a symbol of power and authority. Somehow civilizations from around the world all came up with the same shape to represent something important. Now that's a very interesting coincidence. Number 9. The Shugborough Inscription. The Shugborough Inscription has been baffling scientists for years. It can be found on the grounds of Shugborough Hall in England, an inscription left on the Shepherd's Monument from the 18th century. There is an engraving of Nicolas Poussin's Arcadian Shepherds put up around 1748, and below it was a mysterious sequence of letters, O-U-O-S-V-A-V-V. There is no explanation, no meaning, and the best code crackers in the world have never been able to figure out what the inscription says. This was a pretty big mystery, even in the 19th century. Some of the most famous minds of the age, like Charles Darwin and Charles Dickens, tried to solve the riddle and couldn't. The only person who has even come close is Keith Massey, a linguistics expert who was once recruited by America's National Security Agency. He used his expert knowledge of Latin to fill in the blanks, translating the code into English to, "I pray that all may follow the way of true life." This was something like a prayer that could have been written on Christian tombs. While that does wrap things up nicely, not everyone believes it. One of the more outlandish theories is that the letters are a hint as to the whereabouts of the Holy Grail. Some say it was a surviving member of the Knights Templar who carved the letters into the stone as a final clue as to where the Grail can be found, if it ever existed at all. Number 8. The Taos Hum. The city of Taos in New Mexico is a quiet community famous for skiing and mostly populated by artists and creative people looking for a laid-back lifestyle. Have you ever been there? Taos is also famous thanks to a strange phenomenon that scientists have never been able to solve. It's called the Taos Hum, and it just might drive you insane. The hum is what it sounds like. It was first reported in the 1990s by the residents of the town who described it mainly as a low, droning hum that could be heard no matter where they went within the village limits. Some believe the hum is natural, some say it's a psychological issue with the people who can hear it, and some believe there is an underground base of aliens conducting experiments in mind control. The first man to study the hum was Joe Mullins, a professor at the University of New Mexico. He surveyed the residents of the town and found that about 2% could hear the hum. So Joe set up equipment in these people's homes to see if it could pick up what they were hearing with their ears. His equipment picked up nothing. The only thing Joe found out was that each person described the hum slightly differently, as a whir, a buzz, or a literal hum. This puzzled researchers because clearly people were hearing something, but they were all hearing something slightly different. To this day, science has never been able to explain the hum, although similar situations have been reported in Borneo, Canada, and England. Do you think people are actually hearing something? Or is it all in their heads? Number 7. The Brazil tablet. The Brazil tablet was supposedly brought across the Atlantic Ocean in 1310 by Malian explorers. This mysterious statue was left by the African explorers deep in the Brazilian jungle, then eventually picked up by the English explorer Percy Fawcett many centuries later. The tablet was described as having African pigment and features, clearly not made by any South American civilization, and yet picked out of an unexplored region in Brazil near the Kuluan River. The figure on the tablet is dressed in the fashion of a sailor from the Mali Empire in Africa, probably meant to represent a Malian royal traveling across the ocean on a boat. The tablet implies that African explorers reached the New World far before European explorers. Some say the Mali Empire not only reached South America, but also arrived in North America and built a settlement in the Four Corners area. The presence of the tablet in the jungle suggests they had been exploring when the artifact was lost. However, there isn't much more evidence to talk about. We don't even know where the famous Brazil tablet went after Percy Fawcett found it. It's nowhere to be seen today. Plus, there are no archaeological remains of Malian settlements in the West. They definitely could have made their boats and come across the ocean hundreds of years before Christopher Columbus. But if it's true, the information has either been obliterated from the history books or the evidence has simply gotten lost. What do you think happened to the tablet? Tell me what you think in the comments. Number 6. The Hanging Gardens of Nineveh. For centuries, archaeologists and historians have struggled to discover the truth behind the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. Just like the Great Pyramids of Giza in Egypt, the Hanging Gardens were supposed to be one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. But unlike the others, the gardens have never been physically found. Their ruins have never been uncovered where they supposedly should be in the old city of Babylon. But here's the thing. Dr. Stephanie Daly of Oxford University says the gardens weren't located in the city of Babylon, but 300 miles away in the city of Nineveh. Stephanie also claims the gardens weren't constructed by the famous Babylonian king Nebuchadnezzar, but by the Assyrian king Sennacherib. Stephanie put forth the theory in 1992 and then spent 20 years piecing it together. Her main piece of evidence comes from a bas-relief found in a palace in Nineveh, showing trees growing from a great colonnade in the palace. Plus, the city of Nineveh was also known as New Babylon, once the Assyrians conquered normal Babylon in 689 AD. The whole thing could just be a confusion between the two names. The whole point, though, is that scientists still don't know if the Hanging Gardens of Babylon ever existed, or where they were, if they were ever real. And now for number 5. But first, wanted to say a big thank you to Tactical Rhino and Andrew Jackson. Thanks so much for watching and supporting Origins Explained. If you are new here, welcome, and be sure to subscribe to join the Origins Explained family. Number 5. The London Stone. The London Stone has been identified as a Druid altar, a Roman milestone, and has been standing in London since prehistoric monsters roamed the land. In truth, this mysterious rock is a chunk of limestone seated in a glass case in the Museum of London. Previously, it had been in the iron grille of an office building from the 1960s with a bronze plaque saying its origin is a mystery. And yeah, that's true. There are so many myths surrounding the London Stone that it's hard to talk about all of them. Some say it was used by medieval kings and queens in ceremonies when they took control of London. Another myth is that if the London Stone is ever moved or destroyed, the city of London itself will crumble and die. The bizarre reality is that nobody knows where the London Stone came from or why it's so important. It's just kind of there, and always seems to have been. Some believe it's the magical heart of London when it doesn't appear to be anything more than a brick of limestone. Why do you think the London Stone is such a mystery? Let me know your ideas in the comments below. Number 4. Proof of Atlantis. Depending on who you ask, Atlantis is about as real as Wakanda. Historians generally agree Atlantis is a fantasy world created 2,000 years ago by Plato, the Greek philosopher with a very active imagination. And yet people are still searching for Atlantis as we speak. One of these teams of researchers recently claimed that they discovered the exact location of the lost city, but not where you might expect. This group of amateur archaeologists is called Turanga Seta, and they are pretty hardcore about finding Atlantis. They believe the city is submerged 200 miles from the southern coast of Java in Indonesia. They arrived at this conclusion by looking at codes left behind by the ancient Javanese. They looked at geological abnormalities, traditional stories, and anecdotal evidence to come to their conclusion. This isn't all that scientific, and they haven't found any ruins, but they are confident Atlantis is down there. And if it's not, maybe it's somewhere nearby, waiting to be found on the ocean floor. Do you think Atlantis is real or just a myth? Number 3. Jesus the Shapeshifter. In 2013, people started buzzing about a newly deciphered Egyptian text from 1200 years ago. The text described Jesus as being a shapeshifter. Yes, it seems the ancient Egyptians believed Jesus had the uncanny ability to change his shape. But perhaps what's even stranger than what was written in the old text is that all information about the study vanished after the initial headlines. The story began to cycle through major news websites, then it was gone, and the study was seemingly abandoned. It seems like nobody wants to hear about how Jesus may have been shifting his shape, or what the mysterious Egyptian text is talking about. The text that was found was written in the ancient Coptic language by a distinguished theologian named Saint Cyril of Jerusalem in the 4th century AD. He tells the story of the crucifixion with one major plot twist. He says that Judas's famous kiss following his betrayal of Jesus was actually to make sure it was Jesus. Because he was known for changing shape, shifting skin tone, and morphing between a young child and an old man. It's quite a curious situation. The text is one out of 55 manuscripts discovered in 1910 in the ruins of the destroyed monastery of Archangel Michael in Egypt. The manuscript had been buried for about 1,000 years by monks who had stashed them in an underground stone vault. This is all very strange. What do you think? Number 2. Aztlan. Aztlan is the mythical home of the Aztecs, supposedly the land of the most ancient Mesoamerican civilization in human history, known as the Mexica. According to the Aztec legends, the Mexica left their home in Aztlan to find a new one in the Valley of Mexico, in the area around modern Mexico City. Aztlan was supposed to be a luxurious place situated beside a large lake, where all were immortal and the resources were abundant. When they left this land, the Mexica found themselves in a terrible hell of thistle bushes, horrible weeds, poisonous lizards, deadly snakes, and suffocating heat. Then they made it to the Valley of Mexico and built their new city, later becoming the Aztec civilization. What scientists don't know is whether Aztlan was a real place or not, but what we do know is that there was a major migration of humans moving from northern Mexico and the southern United States starting around 1100. This migration had the native people moving through harsh scrublands filled with poisonous creatures and brutal temperatures. They eventually settled in the region around Mexico City. This much of the story is true. The biggest issue is trying to figure out where in the world Aztlan might have been. It must have been somewhere in the United States, somewhere with moderate temperatures, crystal lakes, and rich resources. But just like Atlantis, we still aren't sure if Aztlan was even real. Number 1. Taming a prehistoric giraffe. The Civatherium is an extinct genus of giraffids. Or in plain English, it was a type of giant primordial giraffe that used to roam across India and Africa. It was one of the biggest land animals in history, looking like an okapi but standing over 10 feet tall. Most scientists agree that the giant giraffe began going extinct 7 million years ago in the late Miocene period, then was completely gone by just 1 million years ago. But there is a bit of a discrepancy. In the ancient kingdom of Kish in Iraq, there was an enormous animal that looked an awful lot like a Civatherium that was tamed and ridden by humans. At least that's what the archaeological evidence shows us. Archaeologists have found rock paintings in the Sahara of gigantic giraffes, painted 8,000 years ago. During an excavation in Kish in the 1920s, an elaborate copper rain ring that was fixed to a chariot was discovered from 3500 BC. It was shaped just like a Civatherium. It was incredible because most rain rings depict things like horses and ordinary camels, but this one was unique, showing an enormous beast that couldn't possibly have existed back then. Or could it? This is what scientists can't figure out. We know that Sumerians tamed all kinds of wild animals, even allegedly taming deer to pull their chariots, but they also seem to have tamed wild, massive giraffes. As unlikely as this, there is a sliver of a chance that some of these beasts, just a few, survived until around 5,500 years ago, and that the Sumerians rode around on them like gigantic horses. Do you think the ancient Sumerians roamed around on gigantic giraffes? Let me know your thoughts in the comments, and thanks for watching! Be sure to subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll see you soon. Bye!